We magnify you. We thank you for allowing us to come into your house. Let your word have a free course. As we decrease, you increase in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So we want to talk about the power in the name of Jesus. The more I preach this last 2 weeks, the more it convicts me even the more that for many of years, I've just been living with the name of Jesus in my head. But I've been missing out on the operation of his name in my heart. You can have knowledge of a thing, but don't know how to use a thing. It's like having a tool that you don't know how to use. You got the tool, but you just don't know how to use it. So you have to have somebody come and show you how to use a tool. So Jesus is like a tool. I have him, but sometimes I don't know how to use him or when to use him. So my job is to show you how to use Jesus in your everyday life. Not just have him in your head, but have him in your heart. You don't mind if we talk a little bit, right? So let me show you what the Bible says about Jesus. Read Acts the 4th chapter, verse 12 and 13, what it says.
Salvation is found in no one else.
The Bible starts off by telling us you can't go to heaven, you can't be saved, you can't be born again, you can't be a child of God unless you have this name. Not in your head, but in your life. Watch what he says.
Salvation is found in no one else.
Yes.
For there is no other name under heaven.
There's no other name in the heavens. Read.
Given to mankind.
Uh-huh.
By which we must be saved.
So the Bible says we can't be saved. And what is saved? I call saved as simple as this. You're in the ocean drowning, and I come with my boat to rescue you. What I'm trying to do is save you from drowning. So the purpose of a pastor, the purpose of a church is to save people from their sins, is to introduce to them that Jesus Christ come to save them from drowning. Now, every day I'm reaching out to Jesus to save me. Even though I asked him to come in my life when I was age 21, still every day I ask him to save me. The reason why I ask him to save me because my flesh is still no good. And I got on a dirty outfit that's always trying to remind me of what I can do and what I used to do. First of all, let's get this understood. When you die, and we all gonna die, your flesh don't go to heaven. Your flesh goes back to the ground. The worms eat your flesh up. It's a scary movie. The worms eat your flesh. It goes back to the ground. It's your spirit man, your soul man, that's gonna live forever. So what's causing you to move, what caused me to move, what caused me to talk is my spirit man, is my soul man. So what I want to happen is I want God to get in my soul, get in my spirit man, and take over so I don't allow this flesh to do what it loves to do. This flesh still loves to cuss. Let me come over here. I think this is the cussing crowd over here. No, it's over here? It's over here? All right, I'll come back over here. It's the cussing crowd over here. My flesh still like to cuss. Yeah, boy. My flesh every now and then sees something that don't belong to me and want to steal it. I'm praying to win the lottery and I ain't even played it. But when that lottery is 100 million or 1 million, I preach against it. But now it's almost 500 million. Lord, give me a number. See, so the Bible talks about this flesh. This flesh is no good. It's always contrary to how God wants me to live. The Bible says, Paul said this, when I would try to do good, when I would try to live right, when I would try to live holy, evil is always present. No matter where I go, my biggest enemy is always going to be me. My biggest enemy is always going to be myself. My biggest enemy will never be my ex-wife, ex-husband, my teacher, or my mama, my daddy, my sister, my neighbor. Your biggest enemy is the person you get dressed with every day, is yourself. But because we're so accustomed to this enemy, we're so used to this enemy, and we grew up with this enemy, we love this enemy. We're used to this enemy. You don't mind if I talk about you, right? Your flesh ain't no good. If it was some good, God would send it to heaven. God know your flesh ain't no good. That's why Jesus Christ had to come and put on a flesh outfit to show us, hey, I know you're going to have marital problems. I know you're going to have drug problems. I know you're going to have health problems. I know you're going to have lying problems. I know you're going to have stealing problems. You're going to have problems with this flesh. Jesus said, but let me put on the same outfit to show you how to overcome you. And that's why you need to be in the Word Church. You need to be somewhere where you can grow so you can fight you. Oh, come on now. I'm from the streets. Yeah, you know what I mean. I'm from the streets. I got an ex-street life, so I know how to hustle. I know how to flim-flam people. I know how to scam people. I know how to lie on people. I know how to cheat people. I know how to hurt people because I used to be in the streets. Then I decided to go to college. Got some education in psychology. Out of all the things, I decided to learn psychology so I can learn people. Then I learned people through psychology. Then I decided to get saved. Got saved, got Holy Ghost filled, and now I'm bonafide a believer in Jesus Christ. So now I got street sense, I got education sense, and I got Holy Ghost sense. I'm a bad man. So what I'm saying is that you got to know you. I still know E-Baby. That was my street name. E-Baby still has some good times. Even right now, I can look back and smile and say, boy, yes, sir, boy, yes, sir, boy. I ain't by myself. Come on now. Yes, sir. You know you had some good times when you was a sinner. Don't sit up in here like you've been all saved all your life. Everybody had some good times when you was a sinner. You remember that nightclub. You're just old now. You remember that boyfriend, that girlfriend you thought was cute? Now they're old and ugly now. So what I'm saying is that you done got older, but you remember what you used to do. And your flesh ain't forgot what it can do. So what you're doing is trying to make your flesh be up under subjection. But the problem is, you want everybody to line up but you. You want everybody to straighten up but you. You don't want to deal with you. You want to deal with everybody around you. If everybody can act right, you'll be right. But that's not how this works when it comes to Christendom. This is not how it works when you become a Christian. You can't deal with everybody. You got to deal with you. You got to make this Bible become personal. What do God want to say to me today? So even though I may preach today and say something about your boyfriend that's sitting next to you or your girlfriend or your husband or your child, don't hunch them. Don't touch them because this word ain't for them. It's for you. When it sounds like it's for him, it ain't for him. It's for you. See, you got to look at the Bible and look at church as though it's a blouse. Come on, women. Come on, ladies. When you go to the store and that blouse is on sale, it's normally $125. It's marked down to $5. It's got purple, green, orange, lime, and yellow all in it. It don't go with nothing you got. But because it's on sale, you buy a $5 blouse because you say it was $125. It's marked down to $5. I don't care what it, I'm buying it today. Because it's going to go with something later. So this message may not go with you today, but eat it anyway, because it may go with something later. So the person I got to deal with is me. So we got to learn how to use Jesus' name properly. Okay, was down at Ward House, Mr. Ward House, a few weeks ago, and we did some shooting down there. Not shoot out, but shooting at targets, because we can shoot in his backyard. So now we down there shooting. Why are we down there shooting? So we can practice how to kill you. We ain't down there just shooting this and be pow, pow, pow. No, no. We're shooting at something so we can learn that if you try to hit us, we're going to hit you first. We're down there learning how to shoot, how to use our gun. My wife, she had my 38, and she was shooting it, and she said, no, that's too powerful. I can't use that right there. I don't like that gun right there. So Mr. Ward had another gun that was a little smaller, and she said, pow, pow. She said, I like that right there. Because her hand stayed in place. Pow, 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 pow. She said, I like that one. So when I gave her the 38, she said, I don't like that one right there. So what I'm trying to show you is some of you don't know how to use Jesus. And you may not like to use him. And many times when you do use him, you want to use him for your advantage. But I want to show you how to use the name of Jesus for the rest of your life. How to use Jesus' name for the rest of your life. The reason why I'm preaching on Jesus so much the last 2 weeks is because I had a severe trial. And the severe trial really hit home for me. And it hurt me, and it scared me, and it worried me. So it was out of my control. So what I had to do was go and talk to Jesus. and say, Lord, please change the situation. Lord, please make this thing do better. Lord, please help me with this situation because it's hurting me to the core. See, when something get to your heart, oh, you're going to cry out for real. And so that's why I'm doing this teaching, so I can show you how to cry out and use the name of Jesus, because your pain coming. Let me come over here. Your pain coming. You ain't got to worry about it. You don't want to say amen right now because I ain't talking about you can get no pot of gold. But your pain coming. Your hurt coming. Your disappointment coming. Your pains are everything. See, the things that you don't want to deal with is getting ready to come to you. And I want to show you how to use Jesus' name properly so that you can get the victory. Now watch this. Your situation may not change, but you can change how you view the situation. Are you with me? Now read Acts 4:12 says what, Alicia?
Salvation is found in no one else.
So the scripture says salvation is found in no other name. Read.
For there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved.
So there's no other name, the Bible said, given to mankind. And when the Bible says mankind, it's talking about every kind. There's no other name whereby we could be saved. You cannot be a Christian without Jesus Christ in your life. You can have Jesus on your mind, but if you don't have him in your heart, you're defeated. I want to be victorious over everything. I want to be victorious over my situation. I want to be, let me say it again. I want to be victorious. Anybody want to be victorious? I want to be victorious. If I don't never get all my bills paid, I want to be victorious. If I don't get healing in my body, I want to be victorious. If I don't get healing in my marriage, I want to be victorious. Do anybody want to be victorious today? Read, reader.
Salvation is found in no one else.
So first of all, let's get this in your spirit. Salvation is found nowhere else but in the name of Jesus Christ. Read.
Salvation is found in no one else.
Uh-huh.
For there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved.
Now, isn't that powerful? So that means, tell me, your mama can't help you. Your daughter can't help you. Your wife can't help you. Your job can't help you. The doctors can't even. There's times when the doctors will say, we've done all we can do. So there's no other name that I need to depend on but the name of what? Jesus. Come on, open your mouth. Say Jesus.
Jesus.
All right. What does it say, Rita?
When they saw the courage of Peter and John.
When people see that you are standing for something, when people see that your mind is made up, when people see that you got your heart right and set, even though you're crying, you still got your mind made up. Even though you're going through something, you got your mind made up. See, those are people that God really used. People that say, you know what, I don't know how I'm going to make it, but I ain't giving up. I'm going to trust God even though I'm going through. I can't give up right now. God, anybody ever thought about, anybody saved? Come on, can I talk to you? Anybody saved? Anybody saved? Anybody saved? About three people saved? All right, since I got three people saved. Now, out of those three people, how many of you all ever thought about giving up? What was the reason why you wanted to give up? Name some of the stuff. Come on, talk. Name some of the things that made you want to give up. Huh? I don't want to deal with it anymore. All right, anybody else? Huh? I'm tired of fighting. All right, very good. Anybody else? Huh? I'm tired of being hurt. On this journey, all that's going to happen. The Bible told me a man born of a woman is of a few days and full of trouble. First of all, you got to get something in your spirit. As long as you're a human being and living, you're going to have some pain. That didn't go over too well. I'm going to stay right here until you get it. As long as you're living, you're going to get disappointed. You're going to have disappointments. People around you, next to you, behind you, sitting on you, they're going to hurt you. So this Bible ain't for them. It's for you. Ooh. Read, reader.
When they saw the courage of Peter and John.
When people see that even though you're hurting, it makes people say, you've been with Jesus. Let me tell you why sometimes God allows you to suffer. He allows you to suffer to get other people's attention. Because some people who suffer, they blame God. But a real bona fide Christian, when they suffer, they still give God the glory. I've heard people say, God killed my mama. God killed my daughter. God killed my son. I say, you can't blame God. Yes, I can. And the reason why they blame God is because they looked at him as only being good. They didn't realize he's a God of judgment. But a real bona fide believer realized that if I don't please him, he can cause me to go to hell. So I don't please him to keep him going to hell. I please him because I really love him. Do you love anybody? Come on, somebody. When you love something, you give up yourself. See, that's why you got marital problem, because you won't give up. You want to release what you want to release. The Bible says God so loved. He so loved the world that he gave his only son. What will you give up for love? I got quiet. But everything always got to be about 50-50. Oh, you better stop listening to some of them rappers. Marriage ain't no such thing as 50-50 in no marriage. There's some days my wife is 95 and I'm a 5. Then there's some days she's 100, I'm a 0. Some days she's 75, I'm 25. And then some days I'm 75, she's 25. So you better be careful when you try to make everything be about justice. I got mad now. Marriage is about love and sacrifice. It ain't about everything going your way. You can't have your way on this journey. When you say it, I do, it's not about you. It's about I give up of myself. So it's the same way with salvation. I didn't get saved so I can love Jesus and love the devil at the same time. Put your left foot in, take your left foot out. Put your right foot in, take your right foot out. You do the hokey pokey and you turn yourself around. See, that's what many of us are doing. We put our left foot in church, take our left foot out. Put our right foot in shacking, bring our right foot out. I got quiet now. So you want to have God on your turn. And you don't realize the devil trying to get you on every turn. I keep trying to tell you, your enemy is never your next door neighbor. Your enemy is never your daddy who sexually molested you. Your enemy is never your ex-spouse. Your enemy is you. And until you get you under control, you always going to blame everybody else. And that's why you need to be in church. You don't need no psychiatrist. You need Jesus. That's all right. Let me tell you something about me. I always feel I'm losing my mind. See, it's amazing. You love my business. But when I try to help you with yours, you don't want to say nothing. I always feel I'm losing my mind. I always feel I don't know whether I'm coming or going. I always feel that nobody loves me. So I find myself walking in how I feel and how I think. So I have to constantly battle my mind, because my mind is under attack. My mind is nothing but brain waves that collects information and thoughts and emotions that's always in the atmosphere. First of all, you got to understand why you have all these emotional breakdowns. It's because the Bible says the devil is the little G god of the air. So he's always trying to feed your mind. And then he try to get in your flesh to make you think that you're somebody, or make you think you're nobody. So you got to bring a balance to your life. And if you don't bring Jesus to your life, you're going to always be confused. I'm preaching. Then you got to get me. So I constantly find myself in a battle where my mind is under attack. One minute I feel strong in the Lord. One minute I love my wife. Then one minute I can't stand my wife. One minute I love my children. The next minute I can't stand my children. One minute I want to drive to the beach. And the next minute I want to drive off the bridge. I'm always going through a roller coaster. One minute I love my job. Next minute I can't stand my job. I'm always going through something. That's why the Bible say put up a good fight. You are under a struggle. And many of us are so used to the struggle that you don't even know it. That's why you have to come to church and let God get past you. Oh, I know what I'm talking about. There's been plenty of times in 32 years of being married and 30-some years of being saved. There's been plenty of times I say, God, I'm through with you and I'm through with her. I'm out of here. But then when I get by myself and the Holy Ghost that's on the inside, say, don't you give up, boy. You done came too far. Don't you blow this right now. Fight, baby. Fight. Come on, baby. You know, Muhammad Ali before he changed his name to Cassius Clay, Muhammad Ali, he went over there and fought George Foreman. George Foreman's 6'5", full of muscle. Muscles all in his eyebrows. Muscles in his ears. And George Foreman was knocking people out on the first punch. Bam! He hit one man who had his arms up like this. He hit him so hard on the hand hit the man in the face and knocked him out. George Foreman was just that strong. And Ali realized, Ali said, I can't beat him straight up. Ali said, let me study him. He sat down and studied the enemy to see how the enemy fight. And he realized, I can't fight the enemy on American soil because he's stronger on American soil. Let me take him to an atmosphere that where he can't breathe that long. Somebody gonna get it. So Ali took him to Africa. And the Bible, not the Bible, but they say, look here. I'm so saturated with that Bible, I think everything the Bible. And they say, Ali was up there, and Ali started going around and around, and George messed around and hit Ali. Ali said, whoo, I felt that. Ali said, wait a minute, let me think. While I'm in the rain getting beat up, let me think. While I'm in foreclosure, let me think. While I'm having marital problems, let me think. He sat there in the rain and came up with an idea. Let me let the devil fight out. Let me let George fight out. He can only swing for so long. Ali didn't tell his boxing managing team what he was going to do. Some things you can't tell everybody. He went into the ring, got up into the ropes, and just stood there and said, let me take his punches. And George came in from New Jersey, picked up speed in Miami, hit Ali in the side. Bam! Ali went up an inch. Woo! Yes, sir, I felt that one. Let me lower my arm down so he don't hit me right there no more. And he kept on doing this here. Roper, he called it the rope-a-dope. He messed around and saw George going too far back because he realized George was getting tired. The Bible said in Ephesians, the 6th chapter, do all you can to stand. Yeah. I don't care how bad it hurt. I don't care how bad you cry. I don't care how bad it looks. You better stand. Tell your neighbor, you better stand. I know you're hurting. You better stand. Don't you give up now. You done came too far to give up now. And George messed around and started swinging out and got tired. He got tired because Ali realized he can't go past 4 rounds. He was knocking everybody out in the 2nd round. Ali said, number one, I got him in higher heights. And number two, he can't go for so many rounds. And Ali said, let me stand for these 4 rounds. And let's see what happened. George messed around and got out of breath. And he stepped back and had to try to get, he tried to find some air. Ali said, uh-oh. Ali got on his dancing shoes in the 5th round. He started dancing and beat George down, knocked George out. They said, Ali, what was the key to beating this big old strong man? He said, I let him wear himself out. I know you're going to hit me, but he wasn't going to win. Do you know you're going to get hit? But do you know you're going to win? Tell our neighbor, we're going to win. Let's go. Let me. I got to go. All right. Luke, the 10th chapter. Luke 10, verse 16. Luke 10, verse 16 says what, Alicia?
Whoever listens to me, to you.
Whoever listened to Pastor Ellis.
Listens to me.
You listen to Jesus.
Whoever rejects you.
Whoever rejects Pastor Ellis.
Rejects me.
You reject Jesus.
But whoever rejects me.
Whoever rejects Jesus.
Rejects him who sent me.
You reject God who sent Jesus. Read.
The 72 returned with joy.
See, now, this is the problem right here. You are looking for your victory so you can rejoice over your victory. Jesus said, you don't need to be doing that. I'm going to explain that in a minute because some of y'all got, I lost you. You were looking to see the victory, to see the results from your prayer. If you're praying about getting out of finance, getting out of debt, you want to see yourself out of debt. You want to say, okay, I don't have no more car note, I don't have no house note. You give God praise. If you see your child sick, you want to pray and say, Lord, in the name of Jesus, my child, get up. And then your child get up, you want to rejoice. Jesus said, no, Christians, that's not how you rejoice. You don't rejoice because you see the results. You rejoice knowing that your name is written in heaven. First of all, you got to understand something. Parents, if you tell your child to go wash them dishes, you don't expect lip. Well, maybe this side love lip. Let me come over here. If you tell your child, baby, go in there and wash them dishes, and that child turn around and talk, look, mama, I ain't dirty them dishes up. Those are your dishes. That child, I hear pain all right over here. They about to kill their child, and the child ain't even did nothing. So what happened is you expect that child to obey you. You don't expect that child to talk back to you. And if that child do talk back, you got to rise up. Excuse me, you want to repeat what you just said to me? Mama already beat her child. You want to tell me what you just said? Because I heard you mumbling out of your breath. I ain't said nothing, mama. I ain't said, you're lying now. Then the mama get up and walk towards the child. Because now the mama letting the child know this means war. Now you're going to wash the dishes in pain. You don't expect the child to disrespect you or disobey you, especially all you have done for the child. So Jesus is saying right here, why are you happy because you prayed and it came to pass? Read, Rita.
The 72 return with joy.
Where we at?
Luke 10:17.
Luke 10, verse 17 says what?
The 72 return with joy.
Jesus gave 72 men power over every demon. He gave them power. Now check this out. If Jesus gave those 72 power, why he ain't giving you none? He say he the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Why is Jesus limited now? Could it be that you don't have results because you're limiting yourself? Read.
The 72 returned with joy.
Yes.
And said, Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name.
Uh-huh.
He replied,
uh-huh,
I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven.
Jesus said, you excited because devils are subject to you because of my name. Jesus said, I saw Satan get kicked out of heaven. And you excited about them being subject to you? Read.
I have given you authority to trample on snakes.
Jesus said, look at this, what he said. I've given you authority. That's why many of us are defeated. Because we don't use the right key. Why are you using a car key for the house? You ain't gonna never get in. It's a key, but it's the wrong key. So why are you using the wrong keys for your situation? The first key that you ought to use is the master key. The master key unlocks all situations, which is faith. Do you believe God can change your situation? Oh, that's all. Do you believe God can heal you? Do you believe God can supply your every need? Then that's the first thing you use is your faith. You give God praise. God, I know you can change this situation. So you make God move on your behalf when you use your faith. Read, Rita.
I have given you authority to trample on snakes.
Now look what Jesus said. Jesus said, you up here happy because you prayed and things changed. Jesus said, first of all, you don't know what's in you. You got too excited about something that you already had. You shouldn't get excited. Oh. Can I break it down for you? Any of y'all ever had, let me do it this way. Any of y'all in here got a tank full of gas in your car right now? Who got a tank full of gas? Come on, raise your hand. You know you crank that baby up, you crank that puppy up and going on about your business, right? Some of y'all came down here by faith. Some of y'all came down here, Lord, please, just let me get to the church. You cranked the car up and the gas light came on. But some of y'all, you already had a tank full. So it gave you the ability to go where you want to go. Now, guess what that means? If you got a tank full, you don't need prayer. You don't need to worry. Because you already know what you got in you. So when you crank your car up, you bet not see E. But those who don't have much gas, you on the edge. Because you know you ain't got, you can only go so far. If you don't put nothing in, you shouldn't expect to get nowhere to go. Bad English, but you understand what I'm saying. So when you know you got full of Jesus, yes. Your baby just got arrested. Oh, Lord Jesus. Okay. To God be the glory. We're going to get past this. We're going to get out of this. That's a full tank of gas. Rain, rain. Yes, yes. You just got a notice. You just lost your job. Oh, my God. My God shall supply my every need. That's a full tank of gas. Rain, rain. Yes. Your wife don't want to be married to you no more. Your husband don't want to be with you no more. Oh, God, please touch my marriage, but God, please give me strength. That's a full tank of gas. So a person who got trouble got a full tank of gas. They know they can go past the situation. Come on, somebody. The person that drove down here by faith, you pray you can get back up that hill. But a person with a full tank of gas, they know they're getting out of here. They don't need no prayer. I got this because I loaded myself up with Jesus. But a person who ain't loaded themselves up with Jesus, they hope they can get by. So watch what it says.
I have given you authority to trample on snakes.
So that's what Jesus said. I've given you a full tank of gas. I've given you a full tank of gas. In other words, I've given you power to tread on that situation. Now, what does he mean by tread? What does he mean in the NIV by tread and trample? What he's saying is the problem you have in front of you, he didn't say you're going to kick it out the way. There's some situations going to linger. Some problems you got ain't going nowhere. He ain't say, I'm going to give you power to kick it out of the way. He said, I'm going to give you power to. In other words, your problem going to stay right there, and I'm going to give you power to dance on it. Some situations you ain't going to be able to kick out the way. Some things you're going to have to stay right there and keep on fighting. You're going to go to bed fighting. You're going to wake up fighting. You're going to have to fight for the next 30 years because you're going to trust Jesus through it all. Read, reader.
I have given you authority to trample on snakes.
What you say?
I have given you authority to trample on snakes.
I've given you authority. You got a full tank of gas. You got the keys to your problem.
Yes.
You got the keys to your problem. But maybe your problem is you. Many of you don't have a problem. The problem didn't come to you. You went to the problem. You don't know how to deal with you. Could it be you selfish? Oh, why are you quiet now? Because I'm in your house. Maybe you're selfish because you can't have what you want. James said, around the fifth chapter, James said, you pray. And you don't get what you pray for because you want it for your lust. Now, isn't it amazing? The car I have, the house I have, the family I have, where I live, what I eat, what I wear, is based on the income I already make. But when that lottery came out, $493 million, yes, sir, I done moved. I got me a gated community. I got a private helicopter because I don't want you bothering me. My wardrobe is now custom made, not cheap made. Everything now got me a chef. I got a new kitchen. I done changed because my money done changed. So isn't it amazing? As long as I was living in paycheck to paycheck, I made it. But as soon as I increased, I got the big head. Now, I don't know about you, but I've spent at least $300 million. I done bought all kinds of private jets, private yachts already. I ain't even played the lottery. I'm praying for it. You should be playing no lottery. You should be playing. I don't play the lottery, but I'm tempted now. As long as it's $10 million, I preach against it. But a half a billion dollars? Speak, Jesus. Give me a number, Lord. Preparation H. Try it for $38. 38, 38, number 38. Somebody say, if you need preparation aid for $38, you need surgery. Somebody want to ask somebody so bad, what's preparation aid? What did it say, Rita? Let's go home.
I've given you authority to trample on snakes.
So look what God say. God say, I've given you authority, so you have power to change you. The first person you need to change is you. Quit trying to change your husband. Quit trying to change your wife. Quit trying to change your children. You change you. Some things ain't going to change. But God, you're going to give me authority to change the way I look at it. Jesus, how did you handle it when your disciples took off running when you got apprehended? The same men you preached to all got scared and left you hanging. Jesus, what did you do when Peter took out his knife and cut Malchus' ear off? Jesus, what did you do when Judas betrayed you and said he sold you for 30 pieces of silver? What did you do when you know he was sitting at the same table passing you a cup? What did you do, Jesus, when your father in heaven turned his back on you because you took on Eric's sin? What did you do, Jesus? He said, I kept my mind strong. I said, how did you do that? I kept reminding myself of my relationship with my father. Even though my father wasn't answering me, it didn't stop me from going to him. Father, if it be possible, could you take this problem from me? And nowhere in scripture will you see where the father answered him. He went back the second time. Father, will you please take this problem, this bad marriage, this bad health, it's bad finances. Can you please take it away? I don't like this. And the father looked at him and turned his back. Then Jesus went to his disciples. He said, I got to find somebody because I'm tired of being by myself. I'm tired of being lonely. I'm trying to seek God and he won't answer me. So let me go to my buddies. And his buddies knocked out sleep. He went and woke his buddies up. Can't you pray with me? I need somebody. I feel like I'm all by myself. I feel like nobody care about me. My father won't answer me, and you won't even be there for me when I need you. He went back and talked to his father again. Father, this is my third time praying to you. You know the devil want to kill me, and I'm scared. Will you please help me? And nowhere did you see in scripture, even on the third prayer, where the father answered him. Then his confidence got built up. You missed that. His confidence got built up even when the father denied him. Even when the father didn't answer his prayer. He said, wait a minute. Let me remind myself of something. My father said he'll never leave me nor forsake me. My father said he'll supply my every need. He bet not lie to me. He said he can't lie. If my father said he's going to be there, I better trust every word he said. Even if I can't trace him. Even if I can't feel him. Even if he don't bring me out. He said he'll never leave me. Somebody shout hallelujah. Hell! Jesus got his confidence up while suffering. You missed that. He got his confidence up while crying. He got his confidence up when nobody was with him. He built himself up and said, wait a minute. God, wait a minute. I done got hit, but I'm coming out rope-a-doping. He went to his disciples and told them. He said, y'all still asleep? They said, yeah. He said, sleep on. I don't need you now. I got this. And as soon as he said, I got this, the enemy bust through the woods and grabbed him and surrounded him. And Jesus looked at him, and all he said was these words, who are you looking for? And the Bible said, everybody fell on their butt. His words, he said, who are you looking for? That's all he said. And all of them fell on their butt. What he was trying to show them is, you ain't got no power. You can't do nothing to me except my Father. That's the kind of attitude you got to have. That's the kind of attitude you got to have. No matter what happened to me, no matter how bad it get, it can't happen unless my Father give a stamp of approval. He said, who y'all looking for? They fell on their butt and got back up and brushed themselves off. They said, we're looking for Jesus. He said, I was in your camp. Why you got to come out in the dark and try to apprehend me? Why you want to try to get me when I'm by myself? Why you want to try to get me when I'm home and ain't nobody around? When I was in the streets, you didn't bother me. When I was at work, you didn't touch me. But you waited till I got home and you attacked me. And the Bible says that's when Peter forgot that that was Jesus, the Messiah. He thought that was just Jesus. He just thought that was just Jesus, the man. I want to pray to that man upstairs. There ain't no man up there. Peter thought he was going to protect Jesus, the man, and forgot Jesus, the Messiah. Peter took out his knife, ran over there. I would like to think. This is the book of Eric. I would like to think he was really trying to stay up Judas. But Malchus got in the way. Are you getting a drive-by stab? You in other people's business and you getting hurt because you're trying to help somebody else? I'm going to leave that alone. That's for you. That's for you. And I like to think he was trying to stab Judas, and Judas ducked. Because Judas know Peter didn't play. Peter whipped that knife out. You better read your Bible. You know that was in there? Somebody said, I never saw that. Peter had it. He was a knife cat. And you know, and I know some of y'all say, well, you know, you're a preacher. You shouldn't have no gun. Why are you down in Mr. Ward House practicing with a gun? You're supposed to be a preacher. Can I help you with that? I got several guns. Don't come up in my house. Don't come up in now one of them windows. Don't let me see you backing up in there. If you're a preacher, you believe God, you shouldn't have no gun. I'm going to help you with that. Peter had a knife. Peter took the knife out, cut Malchus' ear off. Malchus over there screaming with his ear on the ground. Jesus looked at Peter. Peter, put the knife up. You missed that part. You didn't get that. I'm going to come over here. Peter, he didn't tell Peter to get rid of the knife. He said, put it up. I got my gun put up. You made me bring it out. All right, let me try it again. Let me try it again. That ain't go over too well. That ain't go over too well. The Bible said, live peaceably with all men, if possible. So if I'm in an iffy situation, that's all right. That ain't going too well. You can preach the Bible all you want, Rev. I still believe you should have no gun. All right. He ain't tell Peter to get rid of his knife. He ain't told me to get rid of my gun. Merry Christmas to you. What does it say? Let's go home.
I've given you authority to trample on snakes.
Now, see that, Rev? See that, Rev? See that, Rev? Right there. Right there. God gave you authority to tramp on serpents. Yeah, but he gave me a gun to shoot you. Let me leave that alone. Somebody gonna lead a church over a gun. You ought to talk to my wife. You ought to be praying for my wife. That's who y'all need to be praying for, is my wife. Because she want me to be up here preaching with it on my side. She do. She want me to, she said, put the gun on you. When she heard about them preachers getting shot up in church, she don't want her boo shot. Now, you ought to give me faith to believe. I believe God ain't going to let me get hurt while I'm at the pulpit. But when I leave him, my wife want me to carry a gun on me while I'm preaching. Ankle bracelet may come eventually, but right now. Some of y'all gonna be glad when I do carry a gun. Some of y'all, you know, I told people one day, I said, let me tell y'all something. I said, if we get robbed, this church get robbed, they will get the money. They will get all of our money. The problem is them trying to get back up that hill. You'd be surprised how many people on the front. In the front, cars out front, got all kinds of guns. So the crook would come down. It's just going back up going to be a problem. All right, they ain't Bible. Let me get back to Bible.
I've given you authority to trample on snakes.
Yes.
And scorpions. Uh-huh. And to overcome all the power of the enemy.
So look what God says. I've given you power to tread on the serpent in your life. What's biting you? What's attacking you? Are you having financial struggles? You could be having financial struggles because you're not a tither. Are you having marital problems? You could be having marital problems because you're selfish. Or you really have marital problems. You just can't see eye to eye. So now both of you, if not one of you, should see God's eye versus your eye. Your eye should see. I used this parable early at 9 o'clock. Come in, Kelvin. Come in, Kelvin. You got a hold of me. Give me Ephesians, the 6th chapter, verse 12. Ephesians 6, chapter, verse 12.
For our struggle is not against flesh and blood.
All right. Mr. Ward, come stand behind Kevin. All right. You're the devil for right now, Mr. Ward. You're the devil. All right. You're temporarily the devil. All right. You're stroking him. You're motivating him. Now, look who got me. Kevin is the one who got my arm. Uh-huh. Kevin is my problem because I can see Kevin. My marriage problem is right here. I can see it. My children problem is right here. I can see it. My health problem is right here. I can see it. But I ain't paying attention to who motivating Kelvin. I'm too busy fighting Kelvin, but I won't fight what's motivating Kelvin. So what the Bible says again, read it.
For our struggle is not against flesh and blood.
Look what the Bible says.
For our struggle.
Wait a minute. Look what the Bible says. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood. That's what he is. He's flesh and blood. But we keep fighting with person that we can see. And you are not in church to learn how to fight your husband or fight your wife or fight your children. You in church to learn how to fight the devil. Watch what it says.
For our struggle is not against flesh and blood.
But you got struggle. But my struggle is not against Kevin. But I got struggle. I can see Kevin. I can feel Kevin grabbing me. But that's not my issue. Read.
For our struggle is not against flesh and blood.
Read.
But against the rulers.
It's against the rulers.
Against the authorities.
Against the authorities.
Against the powers of this dark world.
So Mr. Ward is motivating Kevin. Instead of me trying to fight Kevin, I need to come over here and fight him. But because I'm so used to seeing Kevin, I won't never fight the invisible as long as I can see the visible. So I'll never get the victory as long as I keep looking at him. Your issue is not your spouse. Your issue is not your children. Your issue is with him. And what does it say, Rita?
For our struggle is not against flesh and blood.
Not Kelvin.
But against the rulers.
But against him.
Against the authorities.
Against him.
Against the powers of this dark world.
Against him.
And against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms.
So look what the Bible says. He got power, the evil one, in the heavenly realm. Kevin just ain't yielding to God right now. Kevin yielding to him. So if I'm the Christian, if I'm the one that's strong in my house, yes, I'm hurt because of the way Kevin treat me. But I got to get past my hurt with Kevin and face this monkey over him. Wow. So what I do is I get on my knees. I pray at home. I pray in my car. I pray over the room. I pray for my husband or my child. Because I realize he the one got a stronghold on my friend or my family member. So my last 2 weeks been a pure hell in my house. And so what I had to do was get sick and tired of being sick and tired. I got sick and tired of being sick and tired. So when there was nobody around, nobody was around, I stood up in my house the other day. Matter of fact, I did it the other day. I did it several days, matter of fact. I said, Satan, in the name of Jesus, I bind you. And I call out who he was. Whatever the devil is doing in your house, call it out. See, this is foreign to you. See, this is foreign to you because you think you need to take some medicine. Some of y'all don't need no medicine. You just need to believe Jesus. You don't need to take another drink of beer. You don't need to go out and have no sex before marriage because I got this pressure, man. I just got to get away. I got to get away. You don't need none of that. All you need is to go and fight this monkey right here. I'm calling the devil a monkey. I ain't talking about no racism right now. I'm talking about the devil. See, if you don't come to church to find out who your enemy is, you're going to always keep fighting your neighbor. That's why we got so many people killing each other. Because the devil is motivating and the people getting mad at the person. I'm out of here. I'm through with you. And the devil said, see God, I made him get a divorce. You couldn't keep him, God. God said, it wasn't my fault. They didn't know how to fight. Eric, how did you reach 32 years of marriage? How did you reach 32 years of marriage? How did you stay in your marriage for 32 years with your wife, one woman for 32 years, from age 25, met at age 24, and now you're 57, she's 61, and you still married? How did you do that? Because I quit fighting her. And she quit fighting me. She noticed some days I act like a devil. Come on, let's be honest right here. I don't care how saved you think you are. There have been some days I just act like a monkey. I act like a pure fool. I'm by myself, huh? I woke up with attitude. I had one yesterday that I was fighting yesterday. Remember, I went to the flea market, hanging out because I want to hang out with my woman. But I just felt funny. Had my music on, and she wanted to talk. So I did one of them numbers. I'm sending a message. I cut the music all the way up. Yes. What did you say? Oh, no, I just asked you a question. Oh, no. Turn up louder. Why did you do that? Because I was in myself. I was smelling myself. I was feeling myself. I didn't want to fight myself. But I wanted to hang out with her. I wanted to bring a nasty attitude to her. She didn't ask for that. So I had to fight myself the whole time I was with her yesterday. I kept fighting myself. Come on, let's go. Let's leave the flea market. Let's go to Costco and look around. I've spent money on my wife with an attitude. Alicia was there. She didn't know I had attitude. Alicia was at the flea market. I had attitude yesterday. But I was trying to be cool with it. I was fronting. But I really didn't want to be bothered with nobody. So I came to the flea market, and she saw a little cooker she liked. You like that cooker? Yeah. Well, get the cooker. We're going to get the cooker. What are you doing? I spent money on her to fight me. I don't know why that went over your head. I realized I was in a bad place. And so I needed to fight myself out of that place. So what I did was pay close attention to her so I can get out of me. So I gave up of myself to make sure she was good. I said, yeah, let's go. I ain't ready to go home. Let's go to Costco. I want to get something at Costco. So we went to Costco. She said, wait, you want some ice cream? I started feeling good. We sucking on ice cream, having a good time driving back home. Then we went home. I took me a shower. I said, let's go to Zaxby's. I got a $25 gift card. Then we drove to Zaxby's, ate the food, had a good time eating food, and then went on back home and just relaxed. See what happened when you fight you? But if you keep giving in to how you feel and you don't never think about the other person, It's always going to be about you, and your marriage ain't going to never work because it's always about you. You didn't get married so you can be selfish, did you? You didn't get married to be selfish, did you? Single folks, listen to this good. This is your blouse. This is a $125 message, but you're going to get it for $5. You didn't get married to be selfish, did you? When you stood up there in front of that preacher, did you lie? I give myself away. To death do us part. I'm willing to sacrifice myself for you. To death do us part. But you really meant, I look for you to fix my dinner and make my bed up. To death do us part. Get my rag up there. Get my rag up there. Get my rag. All them muscles he got. You see, I'm just messing with Kevin. You see, all that power you got, flex a little bit, flex, Hulk, flex. He can't now, he can't now. All his muscles you got, and you can't even beat a little devil. All that power God done gave you, and you can't even beat a bad attitude. He said, I give you power to trample on this. Trample, 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 trample. Don't stop. Don't stop. Get it, get it. Don't stop. I know you're crying, but don't stop. I know you're mad, but don't stop. I know you're hurt. Get it, get it. Get it, get it. Get it, get it. Thank you, gentlemen. So your enemy is not your spouse. Your enemy is you. Everything don't require you to hurt somebody and fight somebody. Some things may require you to step back and look at you. What's wrong with me? Just because you think a way don't mean it's the right way. Do you know I think I'm always right? I said that. Sister Ellis, don't say nothing. Let me preach this right here. Don't even grunt. Just sit there and look pretty. But do you know I think I'm always right? That's a spirit. That's a bad spirit. Just because I'm the tallest one in the house, just because I'm the man of the house, I think I'm always right. So no matter what I say, it's the right thing. It's the right thing to do because I know what's best. But then the Bible tell me he'll give me a wife to be my helpmate. So she got a voice too in the marriage. So I need to let her tell me something. I'm going to automatically think that whatever she got to say is wrong because she's the weaker vessel. If you don't respect what God gave you, then she ain't going to want to talk to you. That's why she's talking to her friends and not you. Because you don't respect what's in your own house. We lie all the time. My husband is my best friend. Lies. Look at your text messages and see who your best friend is. Look at your phone. Your phone will tell you who your best friend is. You don't text your husband or wife. What's for dinner? I don't know what you brought. Ain't nobody at my house, is it? Find out for yourself. So y'all argue with text messages. You debate with text messages. Isn't it amazing? And I laugh at so many Christians. They use Facebook to tell people, to encourage people. I always want to spread this to 10 people. Spread something in your house. If you love the Lord, send this to 10 people. Delete. I ain't got to prove nothing to you. I love the Lord. And I ain't sending. Don't you send me nothing. If you think I'm going to send something to 10 people, you are lost your mind. I don't never send nobody nothing. Bishop, this is good. Send this to 10 people. Delete. I get preachers, pastors, bishops, apostles, prophets sending me stupid stuff. Reverend, send this to 20 people. Are you gonna have new money tomorrow? Man, please, I got money right now. Well, I gotta wait till tomorrow to get new money. I got a dollar right now. Everything is always tricks for kids. Stop it, children of God. Quit letting people hoodwink you. Walk in your authority. And young folks, I'm going to let you go home. Sit down, boy. I'm through talking. Come in. Sit down. You go to the bathroom after a while. Sit down. I got to talk to you for a minute. Come on back. I done been in church too long. Now, young boys, I got to go, man. I'm tired. It ain't got nothing to do. It ain't got no job. I'm just messing with it. But listen, young folks, let me talk to young folks. Young folks, that's why your mom and dad is so hard on you, because they want better for you. They can see in you what you don't see in yourself. Are you listening, young folks? They're trying to get you to say, yes, ma'am, yes, sir, no, ma'am, no, sir. It got me a good job. I got a great job working at American Express with no degree and said, yes, sir, and no, sir. And they hired me on the spot. Young people, they're trying to get you to do better in school because they realize a dumb child can't get no good job. Young people, listen to me. Learn math. You can't count your money and you're a dummy. Learn math. Get into math. Find your career now. What you want to do with life? I'm 14. I don't know. Think of something. Find you a career. Think of something. Go to college. Do something with your life. Don't just sit at home and enjoy your mom and dad air conditioning. Parents, don't be afraid to tell your child, come on, what you doing? Come on, what you doing? Keep pushing it. Mom, you're always pushing it in my face. That's right. You keep pushing that stupid stuff in my face. You keep aggravating me, let me aggravate you back. When you going to college? I ain't going to college. Okay, I'll be back tomorrow. When you going to college? I told you yesterday. I thought I'd come back. I thought you changed your mind. What you going to do with your life? I don't know. Okay, I'll be back. What you going to do with your life? I don't know. Okay, I'll be back. I ain't going to give up. You going to do something. My wife, I didn't do it that much, but my wife was the instigator. She's a pusher. She pushed my kids. Come on. You're going to do this. You're going to go into pharmacist. You're going to be a nurse. My wife was trying to push him. Come on, you're going to be a pharmacist. You're going to go to nursing school. When they were little children, you're going to go to nursing. Go to nurse. Where did they go? They kind of went in that field a little bit and came out. Then they started discovering themselves. Now, you know, my oldest daughter doing phenomenal, doing great. My son doing phenomenal, making excellent money. You keep pushing. Don't give up. My baby girl doing phenomenal. Keep pushing. Don't give up because they acting mannish. They're a little slow around the edges. How many of y'all remember Sesame Street? Snuffleupagus. Nobody remember Snuffle? Snuffle had that long nose and he couldn't even control his own nose. His nose just flapping. Snuff, how you doing?
Well, I'm just posing along.
They ain't bring Snuff too often to Sesame Street. They know Snuff wasn't a good influence. And some of y'all, adults, you're Snuffleupagus. I don't know what I want to do at 50. At 60, at 80, at 80, you should be retiring. The money out there, y'all. The money out there. I'm not going to sit here and preach to you. Come on. Now, money coming. Tomorrow, this time, I see bank accounts being full of NSF. You ain't putting nothing in there. You ain't going to get nothing out.
Don't get on people your debit card knowing you got a minus 100 in the bank. Yeah, yeah. I pray to go through here and take the card right here. Lady took my card the other day. I put my check in late. I thought it was in there. I get a lady my credit card here. Take that right there. Lady swipe. Ding, 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 ding. Lady with that ding, ding. Lady said, let me swipe it again. I said, I got money in there. Ding, 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 ding. I said, what that mean? She said, it said decline, but let me try it one more time. Yeah, try it one more time. Ding, 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 ding. She looked at me and said, I don't know what to tell you. I said, ma'am, let me tell you something. Let me tell you something. Let me tell you something, ma'am. Let me tell you something. I got money on that card, ma'am. I don't know what's wrong with you. I don't know what you want to take this other card right here. Right here, right here. Had to get her another card. Then I tried to play it off. I think there's something wrong with this card. I need to turn this into the bank and get me another card. And they looked at me and said, yeah, right. That's what some of y'all are doing. You ain't got no money in the bank, but you're trying to use a card with no money. Mismanaging your money. You ain't got to be broke if you quit eating out every day. A $10 sandwich at Bojangles, you don't need that. You got all that grease in you. That's why you're sluggish and fat. Look up. Did he just say sluggish and fat? You don't have no energy. The food is not that good out there, y'all. Did you just say you went to Zaxby's? Yep, I sure did. I don't go there every day. I drink about 6 bottles of water every day. 6 bottles of water every day. I know I don't look it. It could be worse. I used to eat butter pecan every day, every night. Butter pecan ice cream every night at 11 o'clock and let it sit there and melt a little bit, that little part that melt around the air, and then you scoop that part.
Yes, sir. That's right.
I ain't got no butter pecan eaters in here now. Yes, sir. Boy, I eat that ice cream, boy. Boy, my belly messed around and grew out there one day. I couldn't even see my feet. I said, I'm fat. And my wife won't even tell me. She loved me so much. She won't even tell me I'm fat. My son was sticking way out there. I went on a fast, left that ice cream alone, left that fried chicken alone, left all that sweet tea alone and all them sodas every night. I said, boy, started losing weight, went walking, felt good, started eating good and healthier. Oh, yeah. Yes, sir. Sexy and I know it. My bad. The brothers are coming. My bad. Somebody said, did he preach or just call himself? You ain't heard nothing I preach. All you heard was he called himself sexy. Now they mad with him. He ain't going back to that church. He called himself sexy. No preacher don't supposed to do that. I was just playing, man. I was just playing. Come on, brothers, go home. I ain't finished. I just stopped because you tired. I did not finish my message, but I do want you to say this. I want to leave this with you. Fight, please. Fight for what you believe in. Quit fighting your spouse, quit fighting your children, and fight the devil. It's easy to have arguments at home, but argue with the devil. Fight the devil. Just go through your house and just tell the devil, say, I bind you in Jesus' name. I cast you out of my house. You leave my wife. You leave my husband alone. Get off my children. Get out of my house. Get out of my neighborhood. Get off of me. I bind the devil in Jesus' name. I'm free. I'm healed. I'm delivered. I'm a child of God. He didn't call me to get a divorce. God didn't want me to go crazy. God don't want me to be sick. I'm healed in Jesus' name. That's where your victory is at. Your name, the victory is in Jesus' name. And let me tell you another thing. You got to stay hooked up. It's just like marriage. You get mad and go into another room. Sometimes you leave the house for a while, but you come back home. You got to stay hooked up. Stay hooked up to a church that's going to feed you and quit going to a church that's going to make you feel good. Your first fight is you, guys. Come on, listen to me. I'm going to go home. I know you're tired. But your first fight is you. Your first fight is you. Your first, come on. What's my first fight?
Me.
Me. Quit fighting your spouse and fight you. Deal with you. You're the bad seed. You're the bad apple. It's always easy to blame somebody else. But you don't never fight you. Fight you. And I promise you, if you fight you, your marriage will be so much better.
Make yourself do to your husband, to your wife that you don't want to do. If you believe God gave them to you, fight for it. You know you got cancer, you'll go and get all the therapy and all the medicine you can to get rid of that cancer. Well, you got cancer in your marriage, fight for it. Amen. You got cancer in your children, fight for them. Don't give up. I decree that your marriage is going to be better than it's ever been before. I decree that your body is going to be healed. I decree, I ain't dealing with your finances, I'm dealing with you. I'm decreeing that everything about you that's negative is going to be a positive. In Jesus' name.